with his trademark hat and a style all his own, he changed the face of football and became an NFL legend. This is a News Channel 5 special. Paul Brown. They called him Coach.
Hi, I'm Gregg Hoard.
And I'm Jerry Springer. Last night, the man they call Coach, Paul Brown, died in his home in Indian Hill. He was 82. He had become a football legend.
Welcome to our tribute. They called him Coach. Now, this was a man who not only left his mark on football, but had a way of touching everyone around him. George Vogel standing by in Wilmington to take a look at the man and his many achievements. George?
Yeah, you know, it's only fitting that one of his last requests was that this football team go on with business as usual. That was just the type of man Paul Brown was, the type of coach Paul Brown was. I had a chance to sit down and chat with Paul Brown a while back, and I found a man who had lived life to its fullest.
He is one of the legends. In fact, Paul Brown's place in football history was secured a long time ago. But before the Hall of Fame, before the glory years in Cleveland, there was Paul Brown the athlete. While at Massillon High, he was favored to win the pole vault and long jump at the state meet.
I never forget it. We, going into the run towards the pole vault or the pit to Broadjunk, there was a real wind against you. And skinny little old Paul couldn't get up enough speed to do much of anything, really. But that's, I didn't do well in either one of them. But that was one of the disappointments to go with a young man in high school.
It was only a minor setback for the young Paul Brown. After becoming head coach at Massillon High in 1932, he built a powerhouse, 80 wins in 9 years. But it was more than wins that made Brown a success at Massillon.
Those guys of mine went to college, catechized to do it from the time they got into junior high school at Massillon.
Brown took over Ohio State in 1941. The very next year, the Buckeyes won the national championship. In 1946, the legend continued to grow when Paul took over Cleveland's team in the All-American Conference. He gave the team his family name. The Browns became the toast of pro football. Brown's innovations added to the legend. He was the first to time players for speed, the first to send in plays from the bench with messenger guards, the first to instruct his players in a classroom situation.
I'm strictly a teacher. A coach is a teacher. It's like you handle the students in your classroom. I applied classroom procedures to the teaching of football. I claim none of this stuff as being anything special, really.
After 4 All-American titles and 3 NFL championships, Brown was fired by Cleveland owner Art Modell after the 62 season. 6 years later, Brown brought pro football to Cincinnati. He was the Bengals coach and general manager. Paul Brown was having fun again, although the early days with the Bengals were as crazy as they were fun.
But in those days, we were an expansion team like a French Foreign Legion. We had people you wouldn't believe. I put in every gimmick or gadget that I could think of to try to pull it out, and every once in a while we did it.
In fact, the Bengals became the first expansion team to make the playoffs in only their 3rd year. After making the playoffs again in 73 and 75, Paul Brown made a tough decision. He retired as a coach.
In my heart, I just felt that it was time.
Paul still ran the Bengals as general manager. In fact, some thought Brown even called the Bengals plays from his booth in Riverfront Stadium.
It was all myth. And I think media somewhat enjoyed it. The public thought that I could never step away. But when I'm in the box at the ball games, I have no telephone to anybody and the coaching staff or whatnot.
One thing that eluded Brown in his time with the Bengals is a Super Bowl championship. Another thing he missed in recent years was the good old days, when pro football was a game, not a business.
It's a far cry from the sport that I originally knew with the Cleveland Browns.
Is that disappointing?
Well, it takes a lot of the pleasure out of it.
In my conversation with Brown, it was obvious he's had few regrets. It was also obvious Paul Brown made a lasting impression on those who came in contact with him, including myself. Paul Brown will be remembered for a lot of good things for a long time to come.
as far as being remembered in any particular way, 100 years from now, who cares, huh?
You may still be running this team then, though.
I've thought about that. Now, seriously, I'd like to be remembered as a worthy coach and person.
Paul Brown was a winner to the end. Paul Brown, dead at the age of 82. There will be a visitation in Massillon tomorrow night for Mr. Brown. Massillon, of course, is hometown. Services in Massillon will be Wednesday morning. A little later in this show, we're going to be joined by Bengals head coach Sam Wyche. Gregg, back to you.
George, it had to be particularly tough up there today. You've been up there all day doing interviews, talking with Sam and a lot of the players. I have to believe that it was very somber, to say the least, up there.
Very somber this morning. Then they started taking to heart what Paul Brown had made his last request, and that is the team go on and try to conduct business as usual. This afternoon, it was almost a rallying point, and now they're going to dedicate the season to Paul Brown, and that's the way it should be.
Indeed, I couldn't agree with you more. George will be back later on, as he said, with Sam Wyche. We'll visit also with Bob Trumpy, who played for Paul Brown and was, as everybody around here knows, sometimes a critic. We'll also visit with Forrest Gregg, who coached for PB and admired the man greatly. That and much more coming up, Jerry.
You know, it's hard to overestimate the significance he had on Cincinnati. There are some things that happened in history that if one person didn't do it, someone else
right.
would. But it's fair to say, without Paul Brown, Cincinnati probably would have still to this day, because of its size, not have professional football. Mm-hmm. That was the man that was necessary to bring the team to Cincinnati.
Absolutely.
Well, we'll be back with some reactions from some of the current Bengals players. They may not have played for Paul Brown, but they certainly knew he was around. Please stay with us. One of the most stellar parts of Paul Brown's career was his time with the Cleveland Browns. He declined to go on camera, but Browns owner Art Modell, who fired Brown in the 60s, did issue a statement on the passing of Paul Brown. It says, Paul Brown was a giant in pro football. He was a pioneer, an innovator, and visionary who started the tremendous winning tradition of the Cleveland Browns. All of us in the Browns and this community, plus many others in football, enjoy this great game because of his efforts. As a personal aside, I was pleased that we aligned ourselves on some very important league matters in recent years. That is the statement of Art Modell, the owner of the Cleveland Browns. And now joining us, former Bengal tight end Bob Trumpy. Bob, thanks for being with us.
Sure, Jerry.
You have the unique opportunity, one, to have played for him, and two, also to have covered him in the media. Quickly, his significance to pro football.
I can't possibly put that into words. I mean, it's already been documented. He's in the Hall of Fame. The coaches he's produced in the NFL, the players that have gone on to I think, be responsible citizens. I mean, he was a tremendous influence at every level. It's hard to find something bad to say about Paul Brown, and his longevity, I think, is probably his greatest attribute, among others. But I felt his wrath as a player and as a broadcaster, and I also felt his affection. So I saw all parts of Paul Brown.
Let's go into that, Bob, because
sure.
Here you are, a young guy coming out of college, and suddenly you're faced with a man who exacts almost perfection from people as players and as human mm-hmm. beings. I mean, mm-hmm. he went over that time and time again. Your first meeting with him, describe that for us, if you would.
Well, it was not personal because it was in a room in Wilmington, and there had to be 150 or 200 people in the room, and we were seated alphabetically, and the T's were in the back. Mm-hmm. And I had to strain to hear what he had to say.
Right.
So my first impression was, and I thought about this today, was, boy, he doesn't stick up much over that podium, you know. We're not talking about a big guy here. Reputation obviously bigger than the person itself. But then as things got cut down and you became more personal with Paul Brown, I found him to be ultimately fair. Mm-hmm. I mean, he was very critical when criticism was necessary. But he could also, at the strangest times, walk up and pat you on the back or just, you know, give you a little aside and a little smile, which we didn't see much as players, mm-hmm. that just, he just exuded the affection at the right time.
Can his philosophy, his conservative philosophy, continue and make it on in the 90s? Does it apply to modern-day football?
That's a tough question, Terry. I don't know about that. There was one way for us to play football. It was Paul Brown's way, and it was a way that was established back in the 50s. He used to, during training camp, bring out an old yellow manila folder and had a day-by-day grading sheet of the Cleveland Browns back in the 50s and would compare us to the Cleveland Browns of the 50s. The reason I bring that to you is that he had it written down, and this was the way it's going to go, and any deviation is just not accepted. I think that was probably the most difficult part of Paul continuing in the game at his advanced age and still being someone who wanted it to be his way.
Right.
I mean, there were constant times when he would refer to, you know, we can go back to the 33-man roster. We did it just a few years ago, and that was 30 years ago. He wanted it. He cared so much for the game of football that he didn't want anyone to crack the egg. And he was painfully aware of that, that he didn't like media types, or he didn't like business types investing in football.
And how come Sam Wyche? I mean, isn't that, considering the reputation we know that that Paul has, wouldn't Sam be just the opposite kind of style of a Paul Brown?
Yeah, but I've long said, Jerry, that I think the hiring of Sam Wyche was a way for Paul to get Bill Walsh. When he stepped down and Bill Johnson became the head coach, Bill Walsh was the offensive innovator. Tiger was a great coach, and he carried on the Cincinnati Bengals as Paul would have. But I think Paul realized that Bill Walsh as the head coach would have pushed us far ahead of the game. And in hiring Sam Wyche, he was trying to make up for all those years.
Bob, we want you to stay with us because there are obviously things that we want to talk about throughout the half hour. Let's move along a little bit. Bob is obviously just one of thousands of players that Paul Brown coached over the years. And even though he's been out of coaching since 76, he still had a big influence on the makeup of Bengal teams. The players were feeling the sorrow in Wilmington today.
Until today, the Bengal camp had been spirited, all eyes toward the season and the everyday pursuits of improved football. Monday morning, with news of Paul Brown's death, thoughts turned to the man who founded this team, the man who'd always had a special relationship with his players. Boomer Esiason came to practice, his thoughts visible to everyone.
Probably the one thing that I'll remember the most was the fact that when I was a rookie, I got a chance to sit next to him on the bus up in Cleveland and on our way to Municipal Stadium. You know, he said to me, "Boomer, don't ever forget the people that came before you to make the game, you know, to make the game a great one." And those words have lived with me ever since. And I think in some small way, everybody out here is touched by the man.
Before practice started, the team paid tribute to the man they called Coach Brown. It was a quiet affair, as PB would have wanted it to be.
He had a quiet little time together in his memory prior to coming on the field. Some of the players and coaches stood up and just mentioned an incident or a moment or a time together, a memory of Paul that kept him alive, at least in our thoughts and prayers and hearts.
To those who knew him and knew him very well, like all-pro tackle Anthony Munoz, there will always be those memories.
He will be missed. You know, used to seeing that little straw hat and him just kind of, you know, checking things out.
When we return, we'll talk with some men who spent a great deal of time over the past few years with Paul Brown, Sam Wyche and Forrest Gregg. Please stay with us.
Welcome back, folks. Joining us live now from Dallas is the former head coach of the Bengals, now athletic director at Southern Methodist University, Forrest Gregg. Forrest, thanks for being on with us. You played for one of the greatest men in football and then had the pleasure, I guess, of coaching for Paul Brown, too. This is kind of a dark day for you.
Certainly is. You know, we've known for some time that this was coming, but even with that, it's kind of hard to believe. You know, you think about Paul and you think about how active he was and what an impact he had on all the people that surrounded him, that it's hard to believe he's gone. He's gone physically, but in spirit, he'll always be with us.
Forrest, Bob Trumpy is here with us, a man I know you remember. And Bob was pointing out during the break that you would always be, or told him at one time, that you would always be eternally grateful for giving you the opportunity to coach here in Cincinnati.
There's no question about that. You know, after I was let go at Cleveland, you know, you don't ever know whether you're going to get another opportunity or not in the National Football League to be a head coach. And I think Paul took a little bit of a chance on me. And I will always appreciate that. He gave me an opportunity to coach a fine football team, a football team that went to the Super Bowl, and I will never forget it.
Forrest, was he difficult to work for?
Now, I can't say Paul was difficult to work for. You know, it's just like Bob said a few minutes ago. You know, he had his way of doing things. And as a coach, you know, he made suggestions to you, but he never told you that you had to do something his way. A lot of times I sought counsel from him. I'd talk to him and I'd tell him to put on his coach's hat. And, as you know, a particular situation would come up and he'd say, well, you know, this is what I would do. And it always made sense. It was always fair. And I think that the one thing that I will always remember and cherish about Paul Brown was that he was really a very straightforward person. You knew exactly where you stood with him. And, you know, I appreciated that as a player. That was one of the things that was so outstanding about Vince Lombardi. You know, he was tough, but he was always fair, and he treated everyone alike. And that's the same way Paul was. He didn't show favoritism toward anybody. And as someone who coached for him, I had a tremendous respect for this man and what he had done in his career. And I knew that one thing, that whatever he suggested or whatever he wanted us to do was always the best for the football team.
Forrest, thank you very much. It's a pleasure to hear your voice again. You're missed here in this community too, and good luck at SMU.
Well, thank you very much.
Take care. The man who took over for Forrest Gregg when he left in 84 was Sam Wyche. And George Vogel has spent the whole day in Wilmington, talked with Sam a lot, and this is what he had to say.
Thanks, Gregg. Joining me here in Wilmington is Bengals head coach Sam Wyche. And Sam, I know from talking to you earlier, you feel you owe a lot to Paul Brown.
Well, I owe him a great deal to my profession. Being a coach is the reason I'm a coach here, especially, is because of Paul Brown. In 1968, I remember as a player having to make a decision about whether to go back to graduate school or to give it another shot another week here. And I asked Paul Brown if he could help me out. Could he tell me if I had a chance? And I remember him telling me that he would meet with me at 1 o'clock in the old lounge right outside what is now my office. And he sat down with a free agent quarterback that he didn't know beans about. And he said, I'll tell you what, Sam, I will give you a chance this Saturday night against the Buffalo Bills, and we'll decide, no promises, but we'll decide whether you've got a chance. And after the game, he said, you've got a chance. I would stick with it. As it turned out, I played 8 more years after that. And through that relationship, the fond memories that he had of me brought me back here. So I owe him a great deal. And of course, those memories are reciprocal. Today's been a very warm day for me in a lot of ways because I'm remembering all the good times.
Certainly a loyal man. And I guess if you were loyal back, he was the best, huh?
Loyalty was one of the traits that he looked for most in people. Loyalty and dedication, commitment, and someone that he could count on. Consistency was a very important part of his life. Everything from cutting that banana in half for breakfast every morning in his cereal to lunch straight at 12 o'clock to consistency with his football players and with his football team.
Sam, I know it's been a tough day here at Wilmington, but like you say, maybe a warm one with all the thoughts about Paul Brown.
Well, that's the way he would have it. You know, he said he didn't want anything to be disturbed. He wanted business as usual. And we've always had warm thoughts for him.
Okay, Sam, thanks a lot for your time. Now let's go back to the guys in the studio. Take her away, man.
Thanks a lot, George. You know, we sat here and we talked about PB and his coaching and what he brought for football, but Bob, you had some other personal things involved with him. As I said earlier, you were sometimes critical, but you and your family had a great relationship with PB's wife.
That is true. Mary has been an absolute godsend to Paul after Katie died. Mm-hmm. And that was very early in our career, in the late 60s. And then he found Mary. It was almost like a rebirth. Mm-hmm. And it kind of made Paul young again. And Mary was such a tremendous influence on the entire franchise. And, you know, Mike's wife, Nancy, has been she's the one that started the banners in the stadium. Mm-hmm. And our families were very close, even though publicly it appeared that we were apart. There are parts of both of our families that spent a lot of time together.
Okay, well, everything we're talking about so far about Paul Brown, the same theme keeps coming through, a man of character. We'll continue with more on the great man Paul Brown when we come back. As it's been easy to see this half hour, Paul Brown is a man who's made his mark and a man who'll be missed. Now for some final thoughts, Bob.
Jerry, it's been a very tough day, and you have a lot of reflection about Paul Brown and his passing. And I think my first impression and lasting impression of Paul was, I heard him say earlier, he was a teacher. Yeah. And I knew him as a football coach, and his teachings were on football. But the older I get and the more I deal with raising my kids, I realize that his little vignettes about life are in fact about life and not about football. And the older I get, the more I tend to remember the things Paul Brown told me. And I think that's the greatest compliment you can pay anybody, that his teachings are lasting.
You're right. I guess all of us would say we wouldn't mind putting our own kids in his
right
hands.
You know, and as a reporter, I have to recall how exacting he was of us. He did not tolerate mistakes. The words and wisdom of Paul Brown helped shape the game of football, not just in Ohio, but everywhere. We leave you with this word from PB and the thought that his final wish may just be granted. Good night, everybody.
As far as being remembered in any particular way, 100 years from now, who cares, huh?
You may still be running this team then, though.
I've thought about that. Now, seriously, I'd like to be remembered as a worthy coach in person.